In the first video sequence, I just showed you chemical reactions and chemical substances. Now we'll try and understand them. I'll use a technique that works not just in science, but in many walks of life. Suppose I'm a cook who's never seen Genoa cake before. I take it apart and look at the bits. It contains what looks like glacé cherries, sultanas, and bits of lemon peel. It tastes quite sweet, so there must be sugar in it. And there's also a matrix, which I know from experience is made from flour and eggs. This method tells me not just the ingredients, but also the proportions in which they're combined. Now there's a way of checking that I've got it right. I put the cake back together again. I go out, buy the ingredients, and make a cake from them. If I've got the ingredients and proportions right, then it will taste just like Genoa cake. Very good. This technique, taking things apart and putting them back together again, clearly works for cake. So let's apply it to a chemical substance.
Here you can see water being taken apart. It's done by passing an electric current through it. Water isn't a very good conductor of electricity, so I've boosted the conductivity with a trace of sulfuric acid. But you can take my word for it that it is water that's disappearing from the solution.
It's being taken apart into two gases. One gas appears at the carbon rod where the electric current leaves the liquid. To get there, the current has to pass through this U-tube of solution from the other carbon rod where the current enters the liquid. It's at this other rod that the other gas is evolved. The gas is passed down sidearms and into test tubes.
The left-hand gas has twice the volume of the other. It's hydrogen, and you've already seen a test for it. But I haven't shown you a test for the other gas, which is oxygen. Let me do that, first with a gas jar of the stuff. This is the standard test for oxygen gas. I light the splint, blow it out, put it into the jar of oxygen, and it flares up instantly. Now let's check that this gas really is oxygen.
There we are. The splint flares up. So, by using an electric current, I've taken water apart into hydrogen and oxygen. Can I put it back together again? I'll use this gas cylinder to pass hydrogen through a jet. When I light the jet, hydrogen burns and reacts with the oxygen in the air. Now, I play the flame onto the surface of a flask full of ice. The product from the flame condenses onto the cold surface. It's dripping off the flask, and it's quite safe to drink. It's water.
So water can be taken apart into hydrogen and oxygen gases. Chemists call water a compound of hydrogen and oxygen. Let's see another example, a compound of copper and oxygen. I'll start by putting it together. Now I could make it by heating copper foil in pure oxygen gas, but it's more convenient to just use atmospheric oxygen and heat copper in air.
Heating copper foil in air soon turns its surface black. The black surface film is copper oxide. If instead I heat copper granules in oxygen, the oxide product looks like this.
I've converted red copper to black copper oxide by heating copper with oxygen. But that isn't the only way of doing it. There's another way that starts with the reaction between copper and nitric acid.
This is often called Remsen's reaction because of the unforgettable description left by the American chemist Ira Remsen. While reading a textbook of chemistry, I came across the statement, nitric acid acts upon copper, and I determined to see what this meant. In the interests of knowledge, I was even willing to sacrifice one of the few copper cents then in my possession. I put one of them on the table, opened the bottle marked nitric acid, poured some of the liquid onto the copper and prepared to make an observation. But what was this wonderful thing which I beheld? The scent was already changed, and it was no small change either. A greenish-yellow liquid foamed and fumed over the scent and over the table. The air became dark red. How could I stop this? I tried by picking up the scent and throwing it out of the window. I learned another fact. Nitric acid acts upon fingers. The pain led to another unpremeditated experiment. I drew my hands across my trousers and discovered that nitric acid acts upon trousers. There seemed no end to the things that nitric acid acted upon. This was the most impressive experiment I have ever performed. I tell of it even now with interest. It was a revelation to me. Remsen's description is a revelation in itself, but the revelations I want to concentrate on start with the evaporation of this solution.
Evaporation leaves a blue solid. This is copper nitrate. Now I'm going to heat it more strongly. More brown fumes appear, starting to darken. Just a little bit of green in the middle now, but you can see the black all around it. There's still that tiny blotch of green in the middle, but at the finish, when the reaction is over, it's all black. This black substance is copper oxide, the same stuff that I got by heating copper in air. A combination of heat and nitric acid has converted copper to a compound of copper and oxygen. So where did the copper get its oxygen from? One possible source is the nitric acid, and this experiment strengthens that possibility. I'll heat the stem of the churchwarden pipe. Now I'll pour some nitric acid into the bowl. The acid decomposes when it reaches the hot stem, and a gas issues from the mouthpiece.
Let's test it. The gas is oxygen. Nitric acid contains oxygen.
I've now converted red copper to black copper oxide by two pathways. In the first, I use the oxygen of the air. In the second, I use the oxygen in nitric acid. In both cases, I get the same stuff. But if I do the experiment more carefully, I can show that the similarity goes deeper than this. It's quantitative. If I start with 1 gram of copper, then by both pathways, I get 1.25 grams of copper oxide. 1.25 grams of copper oxide contains 1 gram of copper and 0.25 gram of oxygen. To reinforce the message, let's take 1.25 grams of copper oxide apart.
In this tube, I've put a porcelain boat containing copper oxide. Passing through the tube is a stream of hydrogen. It leaves through this hole. I'll light the hydrogen at the jet. Now, I'm going to heat the copper oxide. The green colour shows you that some copper has been carried into the flame by the hydrogen stream. The hydrogen gradually snatches the oxygen from the copper oxide and forms water vapour. When the reaction's over, all that's left in the boat is red metallic copper.
Now, if I start with 1.25 grams of copper oxide in the boat, I end up with 1 gram of copper, the amount that I started with. The 1/4 gram of oxygen has been removed by hydrogen.
So water and copper oxide are chemical compounds. They can be broken down into hydrogen and oxygen and into copper and oxygen. But no one has ever succeeded in so breaking down hydrogen or oxygen or copper. Substances like that are called chemical elements, and there are only about 100 of them. Everything that you can see around you is made of about 100 chemical elements. That's a huge simplification. But there's something funny here. I've said that copper oxide contains copper and oxygen, but there's no sign of the redness of metallic copper or the colourless nature of oxygen gas in the black powder that's copper oxide. So what characteristics of copper and oxygen are present in copper oxide? Answering that will be my next job.